My presentation on handling file format issues in Rosetta and beyond is inspired by a poster that we prepared for last year's IPRES conference in Bern. When Adi asked me whether I would like to present the topic of that poster, my first thought were, oh no, I'm sure I'll make a fool of myself. It was the same sentiment I had when I was preparing the poster, trying to visualize some, in my view, rather trivial format issues in order to halfway meet the expectations raised by the elaborate and sophisticated abstract that my boss, Matthias Töwe, had submitted. But strangely enough, the poster somehow struck a nerve, and despite my initial doubts, I couldn't help being a little bit proud when it was awarded the Best Poster Award. So I decided to give it a try. This is just to give you an idea what the poster looked like for those of you who haven't seen it. You're not supposed to be able to read the details. The poster was divided into three sections: issues where we did something, tried to correct the error, then issues where we didn't do anything, just ignored the error or assigned the format automatically, and last, some issues where we will have to do something in the future. You will have noticed that the not to act section is by far the largest. In today's presentation, I will try to illustrate some of these issues, these format identification and validation issues. I will do so from a practitioner's point of view and as far as possible from a Rosetta perspective. How can Rosetta assist us in solving these issues? Where are the limitations of the tools integrated in Rosetta? What other tools can we use before or after ingest? How much effort do we put into evaluating every single validation error? Which errors should be handled at once? And where do we feel safe to postpone actions to a later preservation planning stage? These are some of the possible questions in this context. I may not be able to address all of them or come up with final answers. This illustration is an attempt to show the situation we have in a Rosetta environment. Here's my flock of file formats, by no means exhaustive. Droid and Jove are kind of gatekeepers, preventing invalid files from entering the system. Rosetta rules, validation stack rules, can open a door, or pre-ingest analysis helps to clear the entrance. We can run the files through other validation or correction tools in order to avoid technical analyst issues in Rosetta. Before I go on, I just very quickly would like to set out what we are using Rosetta for at ETH Zurich. Our service is called ETH Data Archive. Our archive contains a variety of different materials. Productive operation started in 2012. To date, we have approximately 105 terabytes of data, which is probably not a large quantity compared to other institutions. We are using Rosetta mainly as a dark archive for materials that have their own repositories for access, and ingests are largely done in an automated way. Now, after all these preliminaries, let's finally start with the concrete examples. They will be grouped by format: TIFF, XML, PDF, and at the end I will add some words about research data. The TIFF format was our first contact with validation issues on a larger scale. With TIFF files, we try to be rather rigorous. Most of the time, this isn't a big challenge, because our TIFF files come in large quantities and in a usually constant quality from our in-house digitization projects. Problems are rare, but sometimes issues do occur. This is maybe a rather trivial example. During some test ingest, we got hold of a large number of TIFF files that look perfectly all right, but Jove says they are not valid. The problem is with the date time field, TIF tag 306. There the year, month and day should, according to the TIF specification, be separated by a colon, but in these files a dot is used instead. This might seem a rather petty issue, given the fact that TIF tag 306 is not even mandatory. But the correct formatting of this field is one of Jove's criteria for a valid TIF file, and we wanted our digitized images to conform to the specification. So we corrected the date stamp prior to ingest using EXIF tool in an automated process. Now to a different case where we only afterwards learned that there might be some action required. There's a handful of TIFF files in our archive that have an ISO JPEG compression and an uncommon color space, YCBCR instead of RGB. Jove reckons these TIFF files to be well-formed and valid. But then my colleague came across a tool developed by the Swiss Coordinating Office for Long-Term Archiving of Electronic Documents, or COST for short, a cooperative venture of Swiss archives. Their tool is called COSTVAL, and it combines Jove with EXIF tool. They have drawn up a list of criteria or TIFF properties that are deemed recommended, not recommended, or critical. And if a combination of several not recommended errors, not recommended properties occur, their advice is to convert the files and to eliminate these properties. Following this advice, we will convert these TIFF files at some stage. They are not baseline TIFF and they are not in line with our internal digitization standards that say that TIFFs should be uncompressed and in RGB color space. My next topic is XML. We have come across considerable issues with XML files. I always thought XML is simple. It is text, it is human readable, and there's an ample specification. But the possibilities to get it wrong are endless. It looks like software vendors do not particularly care about the quality of their XML output. Common errors include invalid schema URLs, fancy homemade attributes that are not defined in the schema, or simply typos. On this slide, you can see two examples of invalid attributes that make Jove throw an error. In general, these are minor faults, in our view, not relevant for preservation. That is why we ignore them by rule. The next example is particular in that the software vendor is not really to blame, and it's a format identification, not a validation issue. We are archiving thousands of METS XML files coming from a specific source system, but Droid is not able to identify these files as normal XML, that is FMT 101. Instead, it gives a whole choice of possible XML formats. Siegfried, the dark blue screenshot to the right, confirms this. But my XML validator thinks the file is fine. And Jove also states that it is a well-formed and valid XML version 1.0. It seems that nothing is wrong with the file in itself. So let's have a look at how the identification is done in Pronom. That's the screenshot at the bottom. The internal signature that allows an unambiguous format identification is the so-called XML declaration at the very beginning of the file, consisting of the letters XML and the version number 1.0. I opened one of the problematic files to see whether the XML declaration was there. It was, and I was at a loss. But I had made the mistake to open the file in my default Office XML handler that displays it in Internet Explorer. As soon as you open the file in an editor or in a different browser, you can see that the XML declaration is missing. Obviously, Internet Explorer somehow interpolated the XML declaration and tricked me. Next, I had a look at the XML specification published by the World Wide Web Consortium. There it says that XML documents should begin with an XML declaration, but it's not strictly mandatory, at least not for XML version 1.0. And that was also the vendor's point of view. It's not mandatory, so we can do without. Under these circumstances, we felt safe to ignore the format identification error and set up a rule that identifies all XML files coming from this particular producer as FMT 101. But there were some other validation errors with METS XML files coming from the same source that were not to be tolerated as easily. During a certain period of time, the source system generated METS files that could not be validated against the METS schema. The XSI schema location attribute only contained the schema URL, but not the namespace URL or namespace identifier that has to precede the schema URL. In order to validate the file against the schema, the XML parser needs both. Normally, we wouldn't have accepted this kind of error and would have corrected the invalid files. But there was a specific reason that made us decide to ignore the error and let the files pass through. It's a bit difficult to explain this special situation in just a few words, but I tried to visualize it on this slide. It is part of the workflow provided by the data producer that after a book is completely digitized and uploaded to the presentation platform, a zip file is created that contains the TIFF images and a METS XML with the relevant metadata. If a correction is made in the source system, for instance, if a missing image is added later, a second so-called delta container is created in addition to the original master zip file. The same thing happens if there is a change in the metadata. So for these invalid METS XML files, correct versions have been created in the meantime. In Rosetta, we archive both the contents of the master and of the delta containers. And when the complete object will be restored in some future time, the old METS XML will be overwritten by new and valid ones. In the previous case, the wrong schema location attribute just caused a validation error. The XML file could not be validated because the schema could not be found. But there are other cases where Jove says that the file is not well formed, even if the Oxygen XML editor says it's perfectly valid. First, we were clueless about the cause of this error because the Jove error message in itself isn't particularly helpful. We suspected, however, the error to be somehow related to the schema URL. It was only with the help of the Open Preservation Foundation that the riddle was solved. They found that it is a special kind of schema URL that provokes Jove to throw a not well-formed error. The cause seems to be a redirect in the schema URL. If the URL is, for instance, redirected from HTTP to HTTPS, the web server responds with the HTTP status code 301 or 302. It looks like Jove, or rather the SAX parser that is used by Jove, is somehow irritated by these response codes and does not even try to validate the file. Instead, it says the file is not well formed and gives a seemingly random error message. In some other examples, the web page the URL is redirected to cannot be accessed either, and we get a page not found error. In these cases, Jove also says the file is not well-formed. Other XML validators declare the files as well-formed but not valid because the schema cannot be found. Of course, this might lead us to the question, what's the point of having a schema in the first place? It often happens that schema URLs are relocated, or at some time they just don't exist anymore. This is one of the questions I don't have the answer to, but maybe we can touch on this object in a possible discussion following the presentation. By the way, our Rosetta METS.xml files themselves do not have a schema assigned and thus cannot be validated. Now let's change to PDF, a tricky subject, and I'm by no means a PDF expert. But what I know from my limited experience is that PDFs are prone to errors, Jove errors to be precise, and that it is not always easy to understand and assess the relevance of a particular error message. From the very beginning, when we started ingesting the content of our institutional repository, we were confronted with a multitude of PDF errors. My colleague took the trouble to analyze each error one by one. He could draw on preliminary work done by the Open Preservation Foundation. There's a very useful list of Jove errors compiled by Yvonne on the OPF wiki. Some of these errors are simply not comprehensible or might even be a bug in Jove. The result was a list of 31 errors that we currently do not regard as a risk for preservation. Main criterion for tolerating an error was the fact that the file is perfectly readable in Adobe Acrobat. We built a metadata extraction error rule that ignores all these errors. The screenshot shows an extract of this rule with a list of possible errors as an input parameter. The rule is restricted to a single producer. With this producer, we have to be tolerant. Most of these files are doctoral theses, some of them uploaded to the institutional repository years ago. We can't get back to the individual authors and tell them, hey, your PDF file isn't valid. Make a new one. We also know that there has been a quality control at the time when the files were uploaded to the institutional repository. So in this particular case, it seems acceptable to have such a permissive rule out of pragmatic reasons. There will be other cases and other producers where we won't be that generous and where we will apply stricter PDF rules. And of course, we will re-evaluate the rule and the errors every so often. The following errors are not included in the rule. In these cases, the technical analyst will download the file to see whether it can be rendered properly. The possibility to configure such rules in Rosetta is a good thing and makes everyday work much easier. However, a rule like this one that is designed for a specific producer only for reasons outlined before does not work when it comes to an AIP update. That is, when a PDF file is added or replaced later on, it will get stuck in technical analyst. That's a bit of a drawback. Finally, let's have a look at the vast field of research data. We already had an interesting presentation on that topic this morning. As a technical university, we of course have to cater for research data. We have established some manual upload workflows that allow researchers to deposit data such as supplementary material that is referenced in the publication or software that has been developed at ETH. But regarding format identification and validation, we do very little, simply because there's not much we can do. Research data is far too heterogeneous, and there are lots of formats that are not yet known to Pronom. Here I listed just some examples I recently came across. There's definitely still a lot of work to be done in Pronom. Research data often comes in plain text. If it has a TXT extension, this gives us at least a clue. But as this extension is associated with a variety of formats in the Rosetta Format Library, there's no unique identification. Where standalone Droid or Siegfried clearly identify the file as XFMT 111. So for certain producers, we configured a rule that automatically assigns XFMT 111 based on the TXT extension. But what about the other text formats? How can we know whether it is just plain text, or whether it's, for example, tab separated, or whether it has a specific encoding? Do we have to check each file for that, or rely on what the producer is telling us? Are we on the safe side if we just choose XFMT 111? Does this choice in any way matter for future preservation? Again, I presently don't have an answer to this question. Any hints are welcome. There are other examples of plain text files with various extensions, not yet recorded in Pronom, or no extensions at all. Often it is code written in a specific programming language or standard output from measuring devices or data loggers. But given the time, I won't go into detail here. Just want to say for all these, for cases like this, we also have configured format identification rules in Rosetta. The examples I previously mentioned are all coming from specific producers we are directly in touch with. They deliver a limited number of formats of mostly uniform quality. In such cases, we can afford to analyze the formats and configure custom rules for the specific producer. But we have a number of manual upload workflows where researchers can deposit a whole data package without us knowing what kind of data it is. Such a deposit might contain hundreds or even thousands of files in various known and unknown formats, organized in a complex folder structure. The example here is source code of some software developed at ETH. It's 120 megabytes large and contains about 1,300 files. Imagine what happens if such a bulk of data ends up in the technical analyst workbench. For this use case, we currently take the easy way out and tell users to pack all the files into a zip or tar file. The downside of this procedure is that we lose technical metadata for the normally or rather small quantity of files that could be identified and that have an extractor plugin assigned in Rosetta. But on the other hand, we are spared a lot of time and trouble because we don't have to analyze all those unknown formats. Rosetta still provides us with the format information for the files in the container that can be identified using the byte stream extraction functionality. The results are shown in the bitstreams tab on file level, as you can see in the screenshot. And the bitstream information is also written in the IE XML in a special bitstream section. There's another reason why we advise researchers to put large datasets with complex folder structures into a zip or tar file. That's the delivery aspect in Rosetta. Bundled Rosetta viewers only allow for a single file download. Imagine you want to download a dataset containing hundreds of files. Users certainly prefer to download the whole dataset as a single zip or tar file that preserves the original folder structure. That's what I called IE download in the Rosetta roadmap poll this morning. I'd like to conclude with some lessons I learned. Murphy's Law probably applies to file format issues too. Anything that can go wrong will go wrong. Even the most meticulous pre-ingest analysis cannot always protect you from unpleasant surprises, although it certainly helps to reduce the workload in Rosetta. Sometimes we just have to be realistic, especially in the domain of research data, where the possibility to exert influence on the data producers is limited. We have to accept compromises even if they are in conflict with our digital preservation conscience. Configuring rules in Rosetta can assist us in being generous in the short term. Rules are a useful tool if you know what you're doing and if you know your files. But rules need to be re-evaluated every so often. And you have to choose your parameters carefully to make sure that not more files pass through than you actually want to. One problem with rules is that there's currently no possibility to add nodes. So the documentation of the rules has to be done outside of Rosetta. With all this in view, it is very important that we try to always keep a door open for the future. Even if we maximized efforts to clean our files in pre-ingest and not allowed invalid files to enter Rosetta, these are no guarantees for successful preservation in the long run. The extractor plugins in Rosetta are few yet, and they have their weaknesses. New knowledge will emerge over the years. New tools will be developed, making it necessary to re-evaluate the files in our archive every so often and plan appropriate preservation measures. Rosetta widely supports us in doing this with its risk analysis and preservation planning functionalities. In order to improve format identification and validation in Rosetta, the integrated tools need to be further developed. This will be a huge task for the community in the years to come. Digital preservation is an ongoing process rather than a state. Well, that was it. I don't know if we have time for questions.
Yeah. So this is kind of a quality control we're doing for our colleagues. But as well, we are ignoring most of the
well. It's good to hear, so we are not totally on the wrong track.
Okay. Thank you again.